This is the Choppin It Up show, brought to you by the Marching Podcast and Blog Talk Radio. And now, here's your host, the Phantom Podcaster himself, Joe Beard.
Good evening, and I thank God for my unconquerable soul. Welcome to the Choppin It Up show. I am your host, Joe Beard, and happy to be of service for you tonight. Today is April 8th, 2014, 6 o'clock on the West Coast and 9 o'clock on the East Coast. We appreciate all those listening live and or all those listening in podcast form, whether through iTunes, Blog Talk Radio, through our website, Facebook, or Twitter. At the end of this broadcast, if you decide you like the show, then we appreciate a donation to the network if you feel so in your heart, of course. Just simply go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on the donate button to help improve the show and help build our scholarship fund. All right, we are in the month of April and getting closer to the end of the school year. A lot of folks, I think I've told you guys in the previous episodes that I've started teaching at a local community college here and getting my wheels and designing some courses as well. So getting myself kind of acclimated to the spring, these new responsibilities and the show. So make sure that you check us out next month, which will be our special birthday month here on the network, and when I'll finish this semester and hopefully have some time. But we're going to chop it up something special next month, so make sure you check us out for some really, really good Chopping It Up episodes. We're also going to bring back the 90 Degree Show next month, where we are going to do the Warren County Battle of the Bands and Drumline Competition. We did that last year. I can't remember if we did it 2 years in a row, but I know we did it last year. And it's something that I would like to continue every year, and we're going to try to put a little bit more effort and a little bit more attention to that so we can help good old Taylor over there on the East Coast, and Rashad as well. I know Rashad and Taylor know each other, and Rashad, that's kind of his stomping ground. So we'll see if good old Block Band will be out there as well. So again, we're going to go ahead and keep coming better than ever in these next coming months. And of course, you can always expect us to be getting on people's nerves and getting people mad this upcoming fall with the 90 Degree Show. I definitely think that I'm going to try to reach out to some of those people who are there on the field at some of these games. I always pick games at random just so we can try to cover as many bands as possible. And I still, to a certain degree, I want to do that because I want to always include the Savannah States and the Delaware States and some of those other bands and the Steelmans and some of those other bands, Fort Valley, some of those other bands that don't get as much attention. But we're going to also try to make sure that we reach out and get more people involved. Thank goodness for Block Band, who given us the great technical analysis, but as well just trying to reach out. This is for the people, just as well as Chopping It Up and the 90 Degree Show. This show is for all of us. It's more than just my opinion, but I'm still going to give my opinion whether, you know, folks like it or not. So something that we're going to continue every year is definitely that Warren County Battle of the Bands. We had a lot of hits over the past couple of years, and a really intelligent young lady called in last year, so we're going to try to grow that a little bit more. So be on the lookout for those things. But tonight, we chop it up with my boy Thaddeus Dixon. Thad is a really good friend of mine. We went to Jackson State together, and we kicked it hard. Thad is older and an established star, so to speak, on the yard. When I got to JSU, he had an apartment off the yard. I can't even remember the place now. but it was considered to be on the way to South Jackson. I remember going over there, but and I know us other folks is, you know, had apartments there, but it wasn't that far from the yard, and it was cool to go over there and kick it with him for all different type of things. Dad was a good guy, and him and I, we definitely bonded together just talking about and breaking down life. Very similar to my best friends, Chris and Jason Hartsfield. We chopped it up with Chris last year, and with them, we talked about the dungeon and the conversations we had about our future. He's also from a city that you'll hear in the interview, but no matter where I go, I always seem to meet some of these people from this town and end up a lot of them knew each other. All of them actually know each other as well. The four people I know from this city, they all know each other, but definitely from that band experience. Thad and I were the same as far as breaking down life and having these dungeon conversations. But it was funny because we also talked about our reputation on the yard. You know what I mean? Like, you know how it was where, you know, how you looked on the yard, who you knew, and, you know, a little bit more than popularity, but, you know, just the social groups that you were part of. Of course, a lot of the Greek organizations. You know, I didn't get my grades together till my senior year, really the semester I graduated. So that is another story, rude to the bros. But furthermore, and getting on with the show, you know, it was really cool that Sat Thad and I were the same. We talked about our future a lot. We talked about our reputations. And, you know, Thad made me realize, and, you know, it kind of bleeds into how we chopped it up with DeMarco Morgan, but it was more about, like, the GPA requirement, you know. And for all you young people out there listening, it is definitely important to actually matriculate at the university. And what that means is to also be studying and to maintain a good GPA. By most standards, of course, with Greeks and a lot of organizations, it's like a 2.5, and that's minimum, but you want to have that 3.0, you know what I mean? And it became part of who you wanted to be around the yard, where you were just this guy, you know, you had a really good grade point average. No matter how hard or however friendly you were, having that grade point average, it paid off, especially as we got older and more mature. It was one thing to be known for that social classification, but another thing to have that GPA. And I realize that's one thing. If we always say we could go back and change things, I wish I would be more committed to the academic side of things, because things would be different. Things would be up and down. But life is what it is, you know. But it's one thing that we could at least get out to the other young folks out there that, you know, when you go to college, you ain't going to really be doing nothing unless you really have a good GPA or a GPA that allows you to be a part of certain things. You know, I could apply myself much more, but never made the connection with that popularity, so to speak, and being that potential productive citizen. You know, McFadden, you know, I learned from him. He was one of the first guys that had, you know, really good grades, but he wore ties to class. And that actually was like the norm at Jackson State. And I'm sure that that's the same, but, you know, brothers dressing up really, really nice for class. As far as women go, you know, they look nice in any capacity or circumstance, so that's different. But I remember Thad dressed up a lot, too. And I remember him, he had bow ties. Because I remember Thad, you know, he plays a certain fraternity. I think that we'll talk about that in the interview. But, you know, part of his swag was that. But he also had, you know, he also dressed up a lot. And I remember him talking about wearing, you know, nice clothes or wearing a nice dress suit to class, you know, just setting you out. But, again, you know, the majority of folks looking to do grown-up things, and it actually made a difference. And that's what you'll learn in college. You know, that was one thing I learned in college, the development of life and enjoying the features along with them. But at the same time, you're making a difference, and you're making yourself look good to the constituents available. So we're going to talk about one of those outstanding folks, sad here. This is a podcast, but we will accept your calls at 718-664-6025. You can email the show at marchingpodcast@gmail.com, tweet us at Marching Podcast, or follow our blog, blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. Our website is under a little bit of construction. One of the widgets, well, actually the main widget thing that we use, actually went out of business, or they closed down, which really, really hurt because I loved them so much. So the things are still available there online as far as the podcasts are concerned, but you know, we're going to add the bands and the videos and the pictures or whatnot once we find a really good internet wizard to host those type of carriers. So definitely still check out the website because you can still donate. The donate button there still works, and that's still all good. Going through PayPal, so, you know, everybody feels safe. Let's take the time to hear from our beloved sponsors. Tonight's show is brought to you by Liquid Effects Photography, Block Band Music, Bandhead.org/HBCUBands.com. Let's take the time to hear from them now.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, grab of 1994 from that famous sonic boom of the South, class of 2000 from the Jackson State University. And guess what? You're chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, are you about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity. Come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands.
Block Band is a minority-owned music business that you can think of as your assistant band director. We help grow your musicians with a great selection of traditional concert band music. Then we back up their performance with necessities like reeds, oil, drum heads, drumsticks, and mallets. Finally, we outfit your players in auxiliary and shoes, spats, and gloves that match our precise custom drills. Got band? If so, then Block Band's got you. Check blockbandmusic.com or call us at 919-698-2560. That's blockbandmusic.com, 919-698-2560.
Hi, this is David McFadden, Jackson State University graduate, Sonic Boom, Trump Funk, Fab 97. You are listening to Choppin It Up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
All right, and we're back, and we're ready to chop it up with Thaddeus. I think this might be someone already has called in. We'll go ahead and we'll take this call, and let's see who it is. Caller, you're on the air with us from the 706 area code. Tell us your name and where you're calling from tonight.
This is Thaddeus Dixon. I'm calling from Augusta, Georgia, all the way live from the campus of the hospital where I'm steadily getting this PhD work out of the way. But I had to take the opportunity to just call in and congratulate you, Joe Bid, on the outstanding job you're doing, and just let you know I'm listening in.
Hey, man, I appreciate it. You are the first person to call in right before we play the interview. So, like, we already got the folks already excited about the potential interview, but also just hearing from you. We really appreciate just hearing from you, man. It's really cool. And, you know, like I say, man, we really appreciate your time. I'm going to play another interview, or I'm going to play another commercial break just so we have time to load the interview correctly. I still got these crazy levels. But yeah, man, so I could actually ask you a question right fast, man. Are you actually studying right now?
I'm just getting these homework assignments in. The studying was done a long time ago. Now I just have to apply the study. I just have to apply the study to the keyboard and submit it for others to ponder upon.
Right. Well, yeah, because, you know, I actually, as far as work is concerned, you know, that was the thing I actually led the people to talk about was how you, you know, were an inspiration as far as getting your work done for me. Because, you know,
that's
I was
right.
ready to come to Jackson State to kick it and party or whatnot. But I had to see the actual folks like you getting the work done. And I was like, man, you know, I actually got to get a nice little GPA myself. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah. I wouldn't expect anything less from you.
Yeah, man. I appreciate it, man. Well, yeah, I'm going to play one more commercial break, probably just for a couple of commercials for the Marching Podcast. So people
good.
Can hear that while we still letting this thing load. But yeah, man, I appreciate you calling in, though, Thad, man, and hope you enjoyed the interview, man. It's definitely a really good one, so really excited about you hearing it, man. And I'm glad you're listening, too. I'm glad you're listening, too, man.
Well, I'm a full supporter, so I appreciate the opportunity, brother.
That's what's up, man. Well, we're about to go live here in a second, so I appreciate you listening in, man.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I was the one and only Thaddeus Dixon calling in, letting us know he is supporting. Again, we're going to go ahead and go to this commercial break because it's having some technical difficulties, but I think that we can get through that. It looks like some of the levels of Blog Talk Radio, they're saying, hey, don't play this and have us sound and have our platform sounding messed up. You know what I'm saying? So I'll go ahead and check these out, and I want to play a couple of commercials for the Marching Podcast Network while this interview loads. So bear with us while we have this small quality assurance check for your listening ears. And, hey, it'll give us a time for you to hear some more interesting stuff and a couple of more of our beloved people who support the network.
Hey, this is Melita Wilson, founder of HBCU Campus Tours, alumni of Bethune Cookman University. We're chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
The Marching Podcast Network is a network of podcasts with the purpose to inspire, educate, and show positive images in our community. Our network produces podcasts about college marching bands, business, health, finances, college preparation, spirituality, instrumentation development, along with one-on-one interviews with strong role models in our community. All podcasts are interactive and invite you, the listener, to call in and speak. Looking for a podcast network that educates and inspires to make our world a better place? Then listen to us at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Check out our website at themarchingpodcast.com. Tweet us at Marching Podcast or follow our blog at blog4.themarchingpodcast.com. The Marching Podcast, changing the world through positive interaction.
Choppin' It Up is a podcast of one-on-one interviews with positive role models that have a connection through music and or education. Choppin' It Up is all about inspiring our youth for a great future and providing a roadmap on how to get there. We also chop it up to give insight to anyone looking for information or hope in their endeavors. Chop it up with us on Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Chopping it up, changing the world through positive interaction.
All right, we're back. And really like that commercial with Christy's voice out there with the good old Black Star in the background. That quality assurance took a little bit quicker than I thought, so that is good news, and hope we didn't lose anyone. But we are still rolling, which is the good thing. So now let's chop it up with Thaddeus Dixon. You're now here with the Marching Podcast, and we have another great guest, good friend, Mr. Thaddeus Dixon. What's going on, man?
Not too much, man. Just enjoying this early November weather in Georgia. Is real nice outside, you know. Down in Augusta, Georgia, the league's looking real good. You know, it's SEC football. You know, just glad to hear from you. You know, glad to reconnect with one of my college homies, one of my, you know, best buddies of all time.
Yeah, man. I was just going to say, I know that I usually start the show with, like, you know, where I know the people from and all that, but, you know what I'm saying? I definitely say we were we were students in Jackson State, but, you know, we used to just kick it hard, man. Just a whole bunch of times,
definitely,
man. So it's good that I always know that you were destined for great things. So
likewise.
I always wanted to put your information out there. And when I saw you and I got reconnected with you, I'm glad that we got your time for the interview, man. So let's get right into it. Thaddeus, where are you from, man?
I'm from a small town called Waynesboro, Georgia. It's the bird dog capital of the world, actually. They raise more and breed more bird dogs than any other place in the world. It's population, man, it's real small. We got one high school. It's right outside of Augusta, Georgia. More people are familiar with Augusta, Georgia for being the home of the Masters. Waynesboro is 25 miles south of Augusta, Georgia.
Okay, that's what's up now. And so you went to Waynesboro High School, too?
Actually, I went to Burke County. It's the county it's in. I went to Burke County High School for 2 years. And then upon becoming a junior in high school, I moved to Augusta. And I actually graduated from the Academy of Richmond County. The Academy of Richmond County is one of the oldest high schools in the country. It used to be like a military school, and it served as a prison at one point. But, you know, if people, those history buffs, you know, they would know that Academy of Richmond County is one of the oldest high schools in the country.
Wow. That's what's up, man. Now, did you march in the high school band there?
Marching is extreme. I'd say we skipped or we walked. It was a core style band.
Okay.
And to be totally honest with you, I didn't learn anything. My band director came from Auburn University. And now when I take a retrospective look, you know, he was actually going through a lot, you know, a divorce, you know, he'd come to school drunk half the time. He throw batons and drumsticks at the students. You know, it was like, basically, you know, our band was like Charlie Brown and the Peanuts. You know, and I was actually a drum major, but no high stepping was allowed.
Wow.
But on the other end, I was, you know, rated the second best trumpet player in the county, you know, in Augusta, and, you know, where we have 10 different high schools. So that was an honor. But yeah, so I was in the marching band, the jazz band, and the little pep band.
Well, that's cool. And you know, since you're from the South, there's more of that marching band, more of the band exposure, you know, than some folks was getting throughout the country. So did you know
Definitely.
That you were going to march, like, did you want to march a marching band in college?
Definitely. I mean, back when I was in high school, even middle school, you know, BET was big about showing, you know, the black college bands, you know, and my sister actually graduated 2 years ahead of me, and she went to Alabama State, and she had an opportunity to march there. And actually, Jackson State University had a former alumni, well, had an alumni by the name of Dr. Charles Smith, and T.W. Josie, which is a nationally known high school, was where he was the band director. So there's a lot of influence in terms of black college-style bands. And, you know, definitely I wanted to do that. So we'd march around, you know, when our band director's out for the day, we'd march around in the class like, you know, we were high-stepping, and the substitute teacher used to leave notes. Oh, these kids were ridiculous. And so, of course, you know, that inspired me to be able to go to college where I could do it on a more formal basis.
Right. So that's what's up, man. So what college did you pick?
Oh, man. I chose Jackson State University. It was funny how it happened because, you know, most of the kids from Augusta wanted to go to Florida A&M. They recruited me heavily, you know, Morehouse. And honestly, I was going to go to Johnson C. Smith at the time, you know, because they recruited me heavily, but their scholarships aren't worth anything.
Yeah.
And so, you know, at the time I was like, you know what, I want to, you know, actually they started recruiting me in the 11th grade. But by the time my senior year came, I was like, man, I don't want to be around anybody I know right now. So, I want to go to Jackson State, you know, because, you know, I heard Jackson State was real far. And then when I looked at them, you know, from the Motown Classic, I was like, oh, okay, that's these guys. So then my mind was pretty made up after I watched them under the direction of Dow Taylor at that time.
Yeah, man. And it's funny you say that because, you know, it's the same thing, you know, you definitely, it's a good thing to go away to school so that, you know, you already know folks in a certain area. You know, it's good that you go away and that, you know, you meet a whole new set of friends, whole new region of the country, you know what I'm saying, where stuff is different, you know.
people have no idea of the cultural melting pot in Mississippi, in Jackson specifically. And I can definitely reiterate what you said, going away, meeting people from St. Louis, you know, Cali, Detroit, Chicago, Africa, Louisiana, you know, so many different cultures right there in Mississippi. So I can honestly say I'm glad I made that choice. And if I had to do it 100 more times, I'd make the exact same choice.
Yeah, man. And that's cool. And that's cool because and another thing that you made me think about, too, there's another reason why we probably hung out with each other, man. You said you were about to go to Johnson C. Smith. Same thing.
Right, right.
You know, I went out there, and, yeah, man, it was a real financial thing, man. And, you know, we actually got into a discussion about that a couple weeks ago when we talked about them on the 90 Degree Show. We were talking about the support and, you know, really the administration and all the people. They ain't really tripping off the program. But I remember the scholarship, like you said, the scholarships were nothing. I remember, I'm sure they offered you about $1,200.
Exactly.
I think maybe a semester or for a year. But the tuition was like $10,000 or $11,000 or something like that.
Exactly. I would have spent that on gas in one semester just going back and forth home.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. Yeah, so I got up out of there too, man. So that's what's up, man. So you went to Jackson State, and you played trumpet when you first got there?
Well, I played trumpet, and it's kind of happened because you know I was more of a concert style trumpet, and when I got there and I heard the likes of the Clifton and the Zeke and the Darnells, those guys were like what you call screamers.
Mm-hmm.
And they were hitting notes, above the stratosphere that I could never even imagine. And so I was comfortable playing trumpet because I knew technically I could probably outperform most people in terms of reading.
Mm-hmm.
But during my crab year, they was like, man, we need to beef up our horn section. So they converted me to French horn or mellophone in terms of marching band. And so, before the year, I actually crossed, playing the mellophone. I was a funky horn, as we like to call it.
Right.
So I switched over to mellophone. And another reason I switched was because I started having real bad migraines, and I was a music major. So I actually switched from being a trumpet performance major to a classical piano major.
Wow.
So, I had a lot of experiences, but I must say that, when I went home for a semester, after playing funky horn, Dr. Adams recruited three trumpets to take my place. So I like to think that I had a lot of testicular swagger on the funky horn, so it was a wonderful time, though. Yes, sir.
Yeah, man. And I remember that story. That's why, led you into that question, because, like you said, you were a music major, too. So you actually changed, and that was part of the something else that I was going to actually get into, which was part of the reason why you picked Jackson State was you're a music major, correct?
Exactly.
Okay, and so could you talk about like your major and you were a trumpet player, but then you became classical. So I wanted to give the exposure about like your actual major or whatnot.
Oh man, I can honestly say that the music major, the music program at Jackson State is one of the finest in the country. We had instructors who wrote for Westerns, who write for, Indiana University. We have, instructors who actually played and wrote for Dizzy Gillespie. So it was well-rounded. And to be a music major there requires you to be in the orchestra. Mm-hmm. It requires you to be in the concert choir. So, while a lot of cats, getting out of a, dinner, and hanging out on the yard, I'm like, crap, I got to go to concert choir rehearsal. because we got to travel to Itabena next week to sing at an old folks home. And it's part of my scholarship requirement. But it was a wonderful, culturally enlightening experience. That's how I really got to go to the different parts, past Christian, Biloxi, Arkansas, all these other places in Mississippi. It's because being a music major, one weekend you're going somewhere with the orchestra, the next weekend you're going somewhere with a concert choir. So it was actually a beautiful time, and I don't regret it. And, being a piano major required a lot of practice. So the smartest thing I ever discovered was that there's no way possible a music major should even attempt to march 4 years in the band.
Mm-hmm.
Because we actually have to do all the theories and, the technical courses, but then we have to prepare for recitals,
mm-hmm.
And that within itself takes up a lot of time. But if I had a choice to do it over again, I'd still do the same process.
Yeah, and it's important because, you know, I always sell the angle from the band because, you know, I wasn't a music major. Well, I mean, I started out a music major until,
right.
you know, I had, I think it was Dr. Thomas's music theory class. And
Dr. Thomas changes a lot of people's minds.
Yeah. I remember, I think my final was, I think he gave us two finals to play on the piano. And I think
right.
One of them was Cheesecake. And I think
yeah.
one of them was like Misty or something like that.
Right.
And man, I don't even know what I played. I know it wasn't neither one of them songs. I tell you that.
And I
remember the look he had on his face. He was like, "All right, thank you, son." And I was just like, "Oh wow," you know.
Oh yeah.
So I got up out
of
there. But you are a really good example of that. You know, it's an intense thing. So, you know, there are people that go march in the band, but the actual music majors that, you know, that march in the band, too, you guys are involved in a lot. Like, the marching band is, you know, one commitment, but
the
music major, like you said, the concert choir, it's that commitment for all of the different ensembles, I remember.
Definitely. It's so intense to the point where, you know, if you're playing, let's say, bassoon, and the constant orchestra, more than likely, they're only going to allow you to march. If you play a brass instrument, or a wind instrument even, they're only going to allow you to march maybe 2 years because they don't want to mess up your embouchure,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they want you as that bassoon player or any kind of double reed instrument like that. So, you know, they go hard in terms of allowing you to, you know, to be in the marching band, to be in the boom, because being in the boom itself is a culture.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're in the boom and you got on those boots or the T-shirt that says the boom, you're a superstar, not only on campus, but in the city of Jackson.
Right.
So, you know, it's so rigorous that if you're a music major, they try to pull you out of that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not from a disrespectful standpoint, but because they know how rigorous it is and they have to keep the quality of the student, you know, for the music department as up to par as possible.
Right, exactly. And that's what it's about. You know, like you said, the quality of the department, because, you know, people fall in love with, you know, the 2 Chainz stuff and they playing in the stands, but, you know, it's
exactly.
learning the marches and it's learning all that's actually learning the craft. You know what I mean?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, I remember like other people than you in the band, but I remember I can't remember his name, but he played trombone. I remember he was a Trey, and I think Roderick mm-hmm. or Broderick or something like that. I wish I knew his name, but he was smart. I remember had glasses and played trombone. One of my crab brothers. I think he was like the play bass guitar in the jazz
band. Oh,
yeah,
band. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Because McFadden was in the jazz band with. Yeah.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, but I was like, damn, you played trombone and you played bass guitar, dog? Like, you know what I'm saying?
Now, he wasn't from Mississippi, was he?
No, I think he was from New Orleans, I believe. I think Louisiana, I believe.
Well, you got to understand, you know, everybody from Louisiana, you know, they're born playing at least 3 instruments off the top, you know. And the reason I guess he was from Mississippi because the culture with Malico music, you know, in the heart of Mississippi, you know, those kids come out with tambourines, you know, connected to their toes. So, you know, they're very skillful at many instruments at such an early age. And that's another reason why, you know, the culture at Jackson State is so intense because, you know, you have so many phenomenal students there that, you know, you really have to be up to par on top of your stuff or else you're just going to be an outcast within the department.
Yeah, definitely. So that's really cool, man. That's really, really cool. So now you were a major here at Jackson State. You know, you did well and everything. Did you have any dreams or aspirations in working in the field after beyond Jackson State?
Oh, definitely. Even as a junior, you know, I started to realize that many school systems, especially like in the north from Detroit, Chicago, even Virginia, especially Texas also, you know, a lot of times their administration has, or those cities have a very, very strong Jackson State alumni program. And so, you know, they're very, very familiar with, you know, the marching band style of Jackson State. So needless to say, you know, I began to become recruited as a music director, you know, for a lot of these high schools.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of my junior year, but I was already, you know, my mind was already set that I was going to come back to Augusta and be a high school band director. And I did. I was very successful at it. You know, people were like, wow, we got this new injection of funk in the city of Augusta.
Right.
His style, his writing style is so different. You know, where's this guy from? And then, of course, when they figured out, they're like, oh, that's why he's from the Boom.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember even going to Johnson C. Smith homecoming and taking on some much larger sounds. And they, you know, they would look at T.W. Josie because, you know, it's a raggedy school, raggedy instrument.
Mm-hmm.
And they would, you know, take us for granted, you know, but when they heard that sound and the arrangements and the color of the music, they're like, wow, this guy knows what he's doing. So, yeah, I was able to meet my aspirations and my ambitions. And I did that for a few years. But then I decided to move on to something that would be a little bit more lucrative.
I heard that. So what do you – so now I know you were – I know you were in the field for a while because I know it's been – I know I finished. When did you finish Jackson State?
You know, I finished in 2000.
Okay.
I finished in 2000.
Yeah, that's right. Because mm-hmm. I remember my senior year. So that's right. You were gone then. My senior year, I moved. McFadden and I, we moved off the yard. And we finished
01. Right.
McFadden finished 02. So I remember not seeing. So after that, you were at Josie for a time. So then, did you then move on to what you're doing now after you left Josie?
I did. I went and got a master's in community counseling and psychology.
Nice.
From Troy
okay.
University. Right. And the thing is, you know, even growing up, I was always told, you know, two of the hardest majors or two of the hardest fields of academia are music and psychology. And, you know, I'm an ambitious type person. So I was like, man, okay, I got the music pretty much wrapped up. So let's do the psychology thing so I can, you know, make a little bit more money and create a professional identity for myself that would withstand, you know, the test of times, the economic hardships and things of that nature. So I went on to get a master's in community counseling and psychology. And today I'm still doing what I was doing when I left Japan, and that is providing private therapy, you know, psychodynamic therapy. I do psychosocial and educational groups for mentally ill patients. I deal with a population of schizophrenia, bipolar, substance abuse, anger management issues, and things like that. But also, you know, my goal is to ultimately teach on a collegiate level, and having a master's and almost being complete with a doctoral degree in psychology has afforded me those privileges.
Yeah, man, that's really, really cool. So what would you say is, like, the best part of working in that field?
Oh, man, learning that, you know, people and circumstances are forever changing, you know, especially with the new zenith of these new diagnoses and, you know, the remedies and the symptoms that are causing them. That's outstanding because then it helps me to really, really deal with people from a civil and from a genuine point of view.
Mm-hmm.
And also being able to use, you know, my first passion, which is music, as an approach that has been empirically proven to be very effective. You know, so in other words, you know, just playing some classical music on any given day for a population of schizophrenic individuals really does a lot to regulate their mood.
Wow.
And, you know, so it's really like it's work instead of labor. You know, I go to work, but I do very little labor because it's something I love to do.
Right, right. So on the other side of that, what would you say is the most difficult part of being in that field?
To be totally honest, the most difficult part is knowing and realizing the underhandedness that goes with the medical field and the field of psychology at times. You know, having gone to an HBCU really allows me or really prompts me to not only care for my race, but really be an advocate for, you know, many disadvantaged or at-risk youth. You know, it's oftentimes they like to label us black men. So understanding that a lot of times, you know, a black male can have or be given a diagnosis of, let's say, schizophrenia, for example, and really it's not schizophrenia. It could be something as minor as adjustment disorder. But because the psychiatrists have money to make and they know they can't bill for one diagnosis, they will misdiagnose our young black men just for the advantage of making their money. And then once they're labeled with that diagnosis, it's hard to get rid of. So now I'm dealing with people and trying to provide therapy for people who are given a disadvantage because they've been misdiagnosed. And to me, that's the hardest thing because it's like, do you keep your mouth shut or do you be an advocate and, you know, you go around with the target on your back? And I choose the latter.
Wow. Wow, that's deep, man. Because, I mean, of course, you know, I mean, you're not surprised as far as, you know, what I guess what they call misdiagnosis. You know what I'm saying? You're not surprised
right.
at that.
Right.
But definitely right. you can see it's. I think it's like with anything, it's hard to remove a label. You know, once you
definitely.
Once you get put in that box, man, you know, it's hard to get out because people won't give you those second chances. And every time one gives you a chance, someone else is quick to say, oh, man, why are you doing that? You know, then you got to deal with the pressure of, you know, saying by everybody else. So that's really, really deep, man. Now, how long have you been doing – how long have you been actually working in the are you working in a hospital?
Right. I work at East Central Regional Hospital. It's a psychiatric hospital in Augusta.
Okay.
It's a long-term care hospital. So, you know, I've been working there. And then I also do private contracts in the community. You know, I provide services with the Department of Juvenile Justice. And that's where I get most of my work from because, you know, nowadays with the mishaps in the black communities as far as the homes, the single mothers, and sometimes even the single fathers, you know, there's always situations that create, I'd say less advised situations where the young man or the young woman gets in trouble, legal trouble. So I do a lot of counseling for them as well, and also for the Department of Family and Children's Services. So I got my plate pretty full in terms of that, and I actually started going and doing that about 2005. So it's been about 8 years now since I've been actually doing what I'm doing now.
Wow. So as far as the juvenile part, so these people have, you know, I guess, been involved with the law, I guess, so to speak, at that point, right?
Right. And to be honest, I mean, because they're mandated a lot of times by court to receive therapy, it's not necessary that they have a mental health diagnosis. In other words, they don't have a mental illness.
Wow.
But you have what you call an Access 4 diagnosis and psychosocial, which means a lot of times they're in a home where there's a lot of domestic violence or substance abuse. And so to keep them from going down that same direction, I'm oftentimes called in and intervene to give them some counseling to help them, you know, have a positive self-actualization and to teach them that there's another way of life instead of the life that they've been exposed to. And a lot of times those traumatic experiences can cause anxiety, you know, depression, or even people, you know, having the need or the feeling to be suicidal. So that's totally different from a mental illness like bipolar or manic depression or psychosis. But it still needs to be addressed. And a lot of times because those kids have anxiety or what you call a learned behavior, you know, if they see their uncle stealing from the IGA every week, then they're going to get that learned behavior and then they're going to steal.
Wow.
So even though they don't have a mental illness, because they've been caught most of the time and brought before the judge sends them to some type of company so they can receive therapy. That's where I come into the picture.
Wow. So I got to ask you, man, because, I mean, you know, being grown now and understanding the system, mm-hmm. and, like, how things work, you know, we mm-hmm. were, you know, blessed to even be in the situation we were in. Because, I mean, remembering, you know, what's always funny, and I don't want to digress too much from my question, but it's just, I guess we grew up to a certain point. You know, we mm-hmm. grew up seeing other African Americans or black folks living okay, I guess, at least to what you want to call social economically was like middle class or whatever you want to say.
Right.
So, you know, right. I remember, you know, you had campus off the yard or you had an apartment off the yard. You know what
right.
I'm saying?
Right.
You had the old Beamer. You know what I'm saying?
Right, so, exactly. Right.
I think we've definitely seen, you know, our people and our peers doing well even through growing up in education. So, like, now you seeing another side of that, you know what I mean, where like a lot of these people
yeah.
may not end up in college, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I guess
mm-hmm.
my question is, man, like, do you find yourself, like, wanting to cry sometimes? Or, like, are you, like, in situations where you talking to these young black men or, like, you talking to these young, and I know you have to hold up to, like, give some direction, but do you find yourself, like, wow, this is really tough? Like, you know what I mean?
Oh, definitely. I mean, it's definitely a situation that you know, warrants, you know, weeping and sadness, you know, when you look at, you know, the role or the direction where the government is headed, you know, our society is headed, and then, you know, our people are headed. And I'm going to be honest with you, you know, a lot of people are like, well, Thad, you know, you have lots, you know, of dreads, they like to call them, but they actually lots. Lots are for intellectuals and dreads are for thugs. But, you know, I wear my hair like this so the people can say, oh, ooh, he's somebody who, you know, he's educated, you know, he's progressive thinking, and he wears dreads. And so that gives him hope. Yeah, so it gives him hope to see, okay, there's another side, and everybody who has hair like mine, you know, is not sagging their pants, or, you know, they don't have a criminal record behind them. So that's my first approach. You know, assimilation is key to them, and they can relate to me. And once they hear me, you know, facilitate with them for a while, then it kind of makes them want to duplicate what I'm doing. Not only in the style sense, but also in the fact that, okay, man, it is possible for me to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
you know, and so, you know, I often find myself, you know, hanging in the urban side of town because, you know, I have to, you know, you can't reach people from a remote control nowadays. You know, it has to be an in vivo experience. And I found that to be not only rewarding and satisfying, but it also helps the individual, you know, just as much as it does myself.
I mean, yeah, I mean, even what you just said right then about your hair, man, like out here in California, I'll never forget, I think this girl, she's from St. Louis, I believe. Oh, yeah, she's from St. Louis, Naya, I have to let her know. I mentioned her name, but she,
yeah.
I think she dated a guy. Or either she was, we were out somewhere at the club somewhere, and she said something to a guy about his dreads, just like what you said. And he said, my sister. He was like, these are locks. He was like, ain't nothing dreadful about my hair, or something that he said, the fact that the word dread, you look up what the word dread is, and then embedded in your mind, then you repeating this word. You know, people aren't even thinking about what they're saying. You know what I mean? So, yeah, that's deep, man, that, you know, you could even educate the folks to say, you know what I'm saying, these ain't dreads. And it's more something our people got to understand, too, where, you know, they got to stop saying dreads. You know what I'm saying?
Definitely. And that's a good point. You know, even my 10-year-old daughter now, you know, she'll be like, my daddy ain't got no dreads. He got locks. And, you know, to hear her say that, you know, at 10 years old, and especially when she goes to a school where there's only 2%, you know, African-Americans, you know, that's powerful. You know, that's righteous. You know, so it's definitely something that more people need to understand. And the truth of the matter is, you know, even our European counterparts don't understand that locks actually started from the black tribes in China. So, you know, it didn't even start from Africa. So, you know, the way they try to, you know, correlate it all, it's all screwed up. You know, we go along with it as African Americans, so, you know, they're going to let it ride. So it's something I try to preach and explain and explore to anybody who has the hair so they can get a better understanding of it.
Definitely, because we don't know ourselves. You know what I'm saying? It's not,
exactly. Exactly.
Know, it's something, and it's just like, you know, we all we got. You know what I'm saying? So, you know,
definitely.
If we don't know,
definitely,
then no one else would know. Well, we come to the end of the interview, man, and it's really good catching up with you, and I'm glad I got your information, so I'll be keeping up with you. And
I hope so.
I know, man.
I hope so.
I want to come to the Honda this year, and I'm really
excited. Oh, man. In January?
Yeah, I mean, I do a show with it every year for the 90-degree show, and I'm making some contacts. But, you know, that's always something I know I'll be able to see. And, you know, little black, you know, Jerome.
Right, from Augusta, Georgia.
Yeah, he lives in Atlanta.
He lives in Atlanta.
But he works with Cortez, you know, with with the Brian management and all that. So I know that they around there, and sometimes he's in L.A. too. So I know I want to try to get up with you, the Georgia boys and all the red dogs out there.
That's right.
So, man, I want to give you some time, man. If you have any information so we can support you or, you know, anything that we should be looking out on the radar or anything that, you know, you want to bring some attention to?
Well, actually, I'm still underground right now, but I'm heavily in the process of coordinating with NAMI. And NAMI is the National Association of Mental Illness. And, you know, as I spoke to you earlier about, my dissertation is going to deal with how music education affects brain cognition. Mm. In other words, you know, teaching someone to play an instrument has been proven to help stroke victims, you know, anybody who has any type of brain injury. You know, music is a powerful thing. So once I can't put anything, you know, out there in public just yet because, you know, a lot of the things that I'm doing is actually being copywritten. But I do want to put this out there. The early part of next year, you'll be hearing some stuff, and it's going to be called Black Freud Days, in celebration of Sigmund Freud, you know, and his whole theoretical approach to counseling. And it's going to be something where African-Americans and people of color can really learn to embrace, you know, mental illness in our neighborhoods and in our communities. And so once I get, you know, the copyrights and things like that, you know, I'll be able to give you a little bit more information. But it's going to be actually bringing NAMI together and, you know, the community. I'm getting a lot of supporters because if you think about it, you know, music therapy started after World War II in the veterans, you know, the veterans' hospitals, because
as most of the soldiers, you know, were depressed and hurt, and music does something to relieve the perception of pain. So actually what I'm doing now is getting with the Wounded Warriors Association and NAMI, and I'm going to start a community band that's going to support mental illness. And first we'll start with a concert band, and, of course, you know, we got to get the marching band aspect, you know. And since I'm actually teaching at Georgia Regents University, their music department is supporting me now. So, you know, early part of the year, by the time you make it to the haunted town, I'll be able to give you, you know, the website, you know, some flyers and all those kind of details so, you know, we can chop it up and, you know, hopefully add it to your show because, you know, I'm hearing a mad buzz about, you know, what you have going on, and I'm looking forward to being a greater part of it.
Yeah, man, well, definitely so, man. I'm sure, I think it will be around that time we'll be, like, playing this interview anyway. So I think, you know, it'll be perfect. And also, too, man, I just thought about, you know, Mara Hall is out here.
Right.
She's
now, wonderful.
Yeah, she is now the president of the Jackson State Alumni Association out here in L.A. So I
wow.
know y'all, and I just thought about you. I did her earlier this year, and so I thought about
mm-hmm.
you guys. You know, y'all were road dogs back in the band. So
that's right. That's right.
Yeah, man. So it's just really good to hear from you, man. You're doing great things, man. And now to see, like, you went to the next level with it, because I always knew you were going to be a band director. Because you talked about that nonstop when we would kick it back.
That's right.
Yeah, I mean.
Right.
I mean,
you remember that?
It, man, it was hard, man.
Yeah, oh, hard.
And I got to catch up with you because you remember, I thought about your roommate. Was his name Eel or something like that?
Right.
So I thought about him. I thought about a lot of folks, man. And
So
I definitely going to catch up with you, man. But again.
Yeah, we kicked it from so many aspects, you know, music, culture, you know, everything.
Yeah.
You know, so we definitely have a lot of catching up to do.
Yeah, and then you took it to the next level where, you know, past band directors now mental illness, and I mean just
right.
I mean it's that's something, man. So so really good to catch up with you, man. And I'll take it up to the end of the interview. But again, man, I'll be talking to you, and thanks again for your time.
Thank you. I appreciate the offer. Take care, bro.
All right, we're back live, and it was really good catching up with Thaddeus and actually hearing from Thaddeus, you know, before the broadcast. He called in, and you are welcome to call in as well. Like I said, this is a podcast, but you're free to call in and talk about Thaddeus. Those seem to be the best calls in my experience so far. You know, we love the 90 Degree Show here, but Choppin It Up, a lot more people listen to that because, you know, it extends more to family members and friends and coworkers. And, you know, when those folks call in, you know, and be like, oh, yeah, you know, I heard from so-and-so, or it was good catching up, it's definitely a connecting thing. I definitely feel warm inside about that type of thing. So we'll let you and give you the time to call in about Thaddeus. If not, we'll close the show. If you are interested in becoming a sponsor to our patron to the Marching Podcast, please contact the show and we'll give you the criteria so we can start to pub your business using our platform. We'll play your commercial, we'll post your website on our blog, and we'll help send out your information through social media. We're also proud to announce that Blog Talk Radio has upgraded the site. Now we're able to add unlimited tags to our show. So we'll start to add the tags for our show for your business as well. So contact us so we can help to build your business. Again, you're welcome to call in to this last commercial break before we hear from our beloved sponsors to talk about Thaddeus or any other topic from the good old Augusta or any of those other things we talked about tonight. Was really interesting hearing Thad talk about, you know, he's, you know, using music with different things and definitely working on that PhD. And you know, definitely, I mean, there's definitely a power in healing and finding out we can do something with music and mental illness. I mean, that's just an unbelievable type of thing. So we'll go ahead and go and listen to our sponsors. But again, if you want to call in and talk, make sure you go ahead and do so at 718-664-6025. Again, we'll hear from our beloved sponsors before we close out the show.
Hello, this is Janice Craig Hartsfield, proud of Spelman College alumni, class of 1964, and you're chopping it up here on the Marching Podcast Network.
What up, bandheads? Are you looking for a talk show about HBCU marching bands?
will look no further than the 90 Degree Show, brought to you by the Marching Podcast. Every Sunday during the football season at 8 p.m. Eastern, we recap the most intriguing battles of the weekend and give you, the listener, an opportunity to voice your opinion on the battle by calling into the show and talking with our panelists. Are you ready for the only interactive show in the world for HBCU marching bands? Then check us out Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. The 90 Degree Show, the interactive HBCU band podcast show.
What if there was a Facebook for bands? Wait a minute, there is. Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org is a social network for HBCU show bands. You can create your own profile and post videos, photos, and comments on Bandhead.org. Need somewhere to post events, audition schedules, job postings? Check out Bandhead.org. Are you recruiting for talent? Go to Bandhead.org. Bandhead.org, a social network for bands. Block Band is a minority-owned music business that you can think of as your assistant band director. We help grow your musicians with a great selection of traditional concert band music. Then we back up their performance with necessities like reeds, oil, drum heads, drumsticks, and mallets. Finally, we outfit your players in auxiliary and shoes, spats, and gloves that match our precise custom drills. Got band? If so, then Block Band's got you. Check blockbandmusic.com or call us at 919-698-2560. That's blockbandmusic.com, 919-698-2560.
Choppin It Up is a podcast of one-on-one interviews with positive role models that have a connection through music and or education. Choppin It Up is all about inspiring our youth for a great future and providing a roadmap on how to get there. We also chop it up to give insight to anyone looking for information or hope in their endeavors. Chop it up with us on Tuesday at 9 p.m. Eastern at blogtalkradio.com/marchingpodcast. Chopping it up, changing the world through positive interaction.
Having an anniversary party, birthday party, or better yet, you're about to marry that special someone? Liquid Effects Photography is the perfect choice to immortalize all your most special moments. With 10 years of dependable professional service that can deliver from the conventional to the best in cutting-edge technology and creativity, come experience the uniqueness of Liquid Effects Photography. We serve the entire Upper Midwest and will travel further upon request. Come check us out at liquideffects.com. That's LIQUIDEFFEX.com. Or call us at 773-454-5556. That's 773-454-5556.
Hi, this is Thaddeus Dixon, Crab of 1994 from that famous sonic boom of the South, class of 2000 from the Jackson State University. And guess what? You're chopping it up with the Marching Podcast Network.
All right. That's all the time we have for the show tonight, and I see that no one has called in, but we're getting close to the end of the hour, so I guess it's okay that we could wrap up the show, and that's all good when we do so. We appreciate Thaddeus' time tonight, and we also appreciate just hearing from the people. We had a couple listeners tonight. I actually can actually recognize some of the listeners or some of the people from the chat room. And we appreciate all those listening, all those who support the network. Again, check us out at our website, themarchingpodcast.com. We are still under construction with that website. But like we said, the donate button there still works. We're still working with some design. We're going to hire someone to do this. Or really interested in the team. We've talked about this on our blog and some previous podcasts, but we really are looking to expand our team, have some people, even in their spare time, help out and assist with what we're doing. We have Colin Wilbon up in San Francisco as our editor, but we also want to add some more folks to do maybe some of the production. I know we chopped it up with Luis Suarez and doing something with the graphics, and we've got some stuff from him. So, you know, we're not big enough to start claiming affiliates, but we're getting there. But as far as building and anything that you think you could help out with the show. We know we want to get more people to buy material from the Marching Podcast. Nail your store. Definitely check that out. You can go to themarchingpodcast.com and click on where you see Marching Podcast. Nail your. And definitely someone to reach out to sponsors to help us get more financial support. We know that you're out there listening, and we believe we have more fans out there than the statistics may say. And the statistics are good, don't get me wrong. But the main thing here, we want to reach out to some more people and expand the Marching Podcast Network to more family, a consortium, a corporation. And we'll get there. We know that you are out there listening, and we reach out our arms and our hearts to you to help out and to assist with the network in any way you can. Again, check out the website at themarchingpodcast.com and donate what's in your heart. Like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter. Thanks to you for listening. And remember, the eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Advice may be misleading, but examples are always clear. See you next time.